الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. Brothers, sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. The Islamic Society thanked me for attending. I thank them for giving me the opportunity and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving me the tawfiq to share some things which hopefully will be of benefit to you and benefit to myself. I also thank everybody here for attending. Jazakumullah khairan. The theme of the talk is something about spending in the path of Allah. I'm sure many of you have heard the slogan, "Let's make poverty history." And generally when we hear this slogan, we in our minds go towards some left-wing socialist, some hippie. But the truth is that there was a time in this ummah where poverty was made history because the Muslims adopted a practice of the Prophet ﷺ which was known as al-ithar. And ithar means to give others preference over yourself. In the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahmatullah alayh, his governor of North Africa, Yahya bin Sa'id, went out to give his zakat, to find some Muslim who could take his zakat. He found nobody eligible for zakat in the whole of North Africa. And then he went to give his zakat to those who are known as dhimmis, who live under Muslim rule. And he found nobody eligible amongst them to take zakat. And then he wrote a letter to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, who was the Khalif of the time, and he said, "I find no Muslim I can give the zakah to, and I find no dhimmi I can give the zakah to, what shall I do with it?" And he said, "See if you can find a slave and free that slave with that money." So this ummah, once upon a time, made poverty history. But this was when they adopted the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They adopted the approach of al-ithar, to give others preference over yourself. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi rahimahullah, he divides ithar into two categories. One is ithar towards Allah. And that means is that when you want to do something, but it's contrary to the commands of Allah, then you give preference to the commands of Allah over your own whims and desires. That's one kind of ithar. And the second kind of ithar is to give preference to others over yourself. And this was something which the Prophet ﷺ deeply inculcated in the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Now often when we, you know, because people generally, and unfortunately Muslims ourselves, have become very superficial in how we view people. So we'll respect a person on the basis of his bank balance. And if he's got a big bank balance, you know, the more respect he has from us. Or we respect a person, you know, which is God-given. Both things are God-given. Somebody Allah has given, you know, nice physical features to, that person is looked up to. And somebody who has less dunya, we look down upon. And this is totally contrary to the sunnah. If you look down on people based on, you know, their worldly gains, then, na'udhu billah, you would look down on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because upon occasion, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam descended upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an offer. Would he prefer to be a king, and a prophet, or would he prefer to just be a prophet, and with no worldly gains, like Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam had the dunya, but he was a prophet, Or would he just like to be a prophet? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam chose the latter. And then he made some amazing du'as. He made du'as which are unparalleled in history. He said, Allahumma ahyini miskinan, wa amitni miskinan, wa hshurni fi zumrat al-masakin yawm al-qiyamah. He said, oh Allah, as long as you keep me alive, then keep me alive in the state of poverty. Subhanallah. So if you frown on people on the basis of, you know, their finances, then a'udhu billah, you're frowning upon the chosen disposition of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma ahyini miskinan. To the degree that upon occasion Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam descended upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, O Messenger of Allah, if you wish, I will change the mountains of Makkah into gold for you. The mountains of Makkah, I will change them into gold for you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declined the offer. And he said, I prefer that I eat one day and I do shukr. I eat one day and I do shukr. And the next day I fast and I do sabr. Allahumma ahyini miskinan. Oh Allah, as long as you keep me alive in the state of poverty. I see, this poverty was not a poverty where the problem, it was a chosen poverty. You have two types of poverty. One is when you're afflicted with a poverty, and that can often be a fitna. And the other is where you choose to be poor. The Prophet ﷺ sometimes had so much wealth that he would begin to distribute in the morning, and evening would fall and he would not have finished with the distribution. There would be still certain things left behind. And he said, Allahumma ahyini miskinan wa amitni miskinan. And oh Allah, as long as I live, keep me alive in poverty. And the day I leave this dunya, oh Allah, take me away from this dunya in the state of poverty. And Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was breathing his last, he only had 6 dirhams. That's all he had in his possession, was 6 dirhams. And he said to Aisha, he said, Aisha, you know those 6 dirhams I have? Give them in the path of Allah. And Aisha radiallahu anha says, I became busy attending to the Messenger of Allah, and he became unconscious. And when he regained consciousness, the first thing he said, oh Aisha, have you given those 6 dirhams in the path of Allah? And Aisha radiallahu anha said, oh Messenger of Allah, I was busy attending to you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, oh Aisha, what will I do when I stand in front of Allah and I will have wealth in my possession? Allahumma ahyini miskinan wa amitni miskinan wa hshurni fi zumrat al-masakini yawm al-qiyamah. Not only in this dunya, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, even not just in this dunya, even in the hereafter, when you resurrect me and when you take me into account with the poor people. And the ulama write, he said, this is amazing. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't say, take the poor people into account with me. He said, take my account with them. And the ulama write, this is an honor for those who are poor, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to be with them. And this is why he told Aisha, he said, Aisha, remain in the company of poor people, because generally they remember Allah. But what I'm getting at is that sometimes we are very superficial ways how we judge people. We judge them on the basis of the cars that they drive. We judge them on the clothes that they wear, their bank balances. But very rarely do we judge people on the basis of their manners, of their deen, of how God-fearing they are, how caring they are for other people. And this was something which the Prophet ﷺ instilled in the Sahaba. He made them people of Ithar, who gave preference to other people. Upon occasion, in some narration that these were prisoners of war, and they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to feed them, and he had nothing to feed them with. He sent the Sahaba to every single one of his wives to ask, was there anything that they could feed these people with? Every single home they went to, there was nothing in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
There's nothing in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Often there was nothing in the house of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imran ibn Husayn mentions, one day I saw the Messenger of Allah, and the Messenger of Allah said, "Oh Imran, I am going to visit Fatima, she's ill, do you want to come accompany me?" And he said, "Indeed, O Messenger of Allah." And Imran mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knocked on the door of the house, and Fatima answers, he asked, "Who is it?" And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "It's your father. And with me is Imran ibn Husayn." And Fatima radiallahu anha said, "O Messenger of Allah, I have nothing to cover my hair with." And Imran mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took off his blessed cloak and he gave it to Fatima and she covered her hair with it. And then Imran ibn Husayn and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered the house and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked her, "How are you? How are you?" And she said, "Oh my father, I'm ill." And the situation exasperated by the fact that for days I've eaten nothing. And Imran mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam began to weep, he began to cry. And he said, "Oh Fatima, have sabr. Oh Fatima, have sabr. Oh Fatima, have sabr. For I swear by Allah, your father has not tasted anything for 3 days. For 3 days, this was the greatest of creation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For 3 days, I mean imagine, seriously imagine yourself not having something to eat for 3 days. Imagine not having meat for 3 days. You know there are people, you know, Iftar Relief, brothers from Birmingham, who just went to Eritrea. You know, those they're Muslims. The only time they have meat is on Eid al-Adha. Once a year they have meat. And we still complain. And we still are not in the state of shukr. You know, the food's no good. After the food, you know, it's a 3-course meal, the brother's telling me, after the talk. If it wasn't a 3-course meal, you know, how many people would have attended? You know, and this is a sad situation. But, you know, look at other people. And if you look at those below you, you will always be in the state of shukr. The Prophet ﷺ told Abu Dharr, he said, "Look at those who be, always look at those who are beneath you, and never look at those who are above you. Because see, as long as you're looking at those who are beneath you, you will always be in the state of shukr. And if you're looking at those who are above you, got more than you, then you'll always find people who got more than you, and you'll end up on Prozac. You know, you'll suffer from depression." Because this is the nature of the dunya. People will have more than you. So you do shukr and you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He has given you. In shakartum la'azidannakum. If you do shukr, then Allah will increase. But what is shukr? You know, we in our culture is like shukr is alhamdulillah. Easy shukr. Well, that is shukr, but the optimum shukr is that which Allah has given you, spend it in a manner which is pleasing to Him. And this doesn't mean, look, you can't have a car, you can't have a nice house. It doesn't mean that. What it means is that you don't engross your entire life in pursuit of these frivolous things. That's what it means. Because you had Sahaba, you know, who had nice horses, who has nice houses. You had examples from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But they would never allow a person to starve to death. You know, we live in a global village now. We see the suffering of other human beings. You know, today, 800 million people. I mean, this is amazing, isn't it? You know, we talk about human rights abuses. Today, 800 million people will go to sleep hungry. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, none of you can be a true believer. None of you can be a true believer that his neighbor sleeps hungry. He's your neighbor, seriously. He's your neighbor. Because you live in a global village, you can assist him. None of you can be a true believer that your neighbor sleeps hungry. And 800 million people, 30,000 children will die of poverty or poverty-related diseases today. Today. And we still have room to complain. We still have room to complain. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent the Sahaba to his home. Each and every home, and there was nothing. Nobody had anything at home. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked amongst the Sahaba, is there anybody who can free the prisoners of war? And there was a Sahabi called Abu Talha al-Ansari radiallahu anhu. He was an amazing Sahabi. Abu Talha al-Ansari said, oh Messenger of Allah, I'll take him home and I'll feed him. And he went home and he asked his wife, he said, do we have anything to feed these prisoners with, the guests of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And she said, we only have enough food to feed our children with. And he said, put them to sleep. Put them to sleep hungry. So she put them to sleep hungry. Then she said, the food is only enough for the guests, not enough for all of us. What he said, when you place the food on the table, pretend you are fixing the lantern and make it go off. And we will pretend that we are eating with them. So they will eat. And this is what they did. They remained hungry, the children remained hungry, and they fed their guests. Only them and Allah knew. And the next day, Abu Talha al-Ansari radiallahu anhu came into the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh glad tidings Talha, Allah has revealed verses regarding you. يُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. They give preference to others, even if they are in need themselves. And this was Isar. You know, Abu Talha al-Ansari was amazing because he was a Sahabi. When the verse said, لَنْ تَنَالُوا بِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا بِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ, none of you will attain piety until he spends from that which he loves. None of you can really attain piety. So if there's something that you love, you know, spend it. Because Allah will give you more. What you have is from Allah. And if you spend, Allah will give you more. Allah promises. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Thalathun uqsimu alayhinna." Three things I take an oath upon. Who's taking that oath? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ma nakhasa malu 'abdin min sadaqa." No man's wealth will decrease if he gives in the path of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took an oath upon it. And it may apparently decrease, but Allah will put barakah in it. Allah will facilitate from other avenues. Because this is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when the verses were revealed, none of you will attain piety until he spends from that which he loves. Abu Talha loved this garden, which is still, it actually falls in Masjid Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Still falls, it's called Bi'r al-Ruma. If you enter the masjid from the Bab King Malik Fahd, slightly on your left hand side, they have a carpet. If you move the carpet, under it, they still got the signs. This was where Bi'r al-Ruma was. The Prophet ﷺ loved to drink from the well of Bi'r al-Ruma. This was a beautiful garden. When the verses were revealed that none of you will attain a piety until he spends from that which he loves, Abu Talha said, O Messenger of Allah, the most beloved thing to me is the garden with the well. I give it in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I give it in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's amazing, isn't it? These are the places where, you know, Ithar was founded. These were the places where Ithar was founded. It was in the Masjid Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the battle of Khaybar, he was distributing the wealth. He was distributing the wealth. From morning to evening he distributed the wealth. And his wives are waiting, when will the Messenger of Allah send something home? And when literally everything was finished, they sent a message to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Said, O Messenger of Allah, you're caring about everybody else, but what about your own family? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, he became upset. And then Allah revealed the verses. O Messenger of Allah, say to your wives, إِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِنَّ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَزِينَتَهَا. If you want, say to your wives, if you want the life of the dunya and its adornment, then come, we will give it to you. But you will go your way, we will go our way. But if it is Allah and the Rasul that you wish, and the Darul Akhirah, and the hereafter, the abode of the hereafter, which we have prepared for the pious women, then you would have to do sabr in this dunya. And these were the places where Ithar took place. Abu Talha, the Messenger of Allah. And it's amazing, isn't it? You walk from the Rawdah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then you walk past the house of Abu Talha, the house of the Sahaba. Then you walk past Bi'r al-Rumah. And you walk outside the Masjid. And where do you reach? You reach the Hilton Hotel. You know, you reach the Kentucky Fried Chickens and the McDonald's. You know, this was a place where there should have been madaris. There should have been welfare institutes. And then just half a mile past, no exaggeration, you pass these Hilton hotels and all these expensive shops. You take a left, there's a Mauritanian community there. There's a Mauritanian community. And really, they live in such poverty, it's unbelievable. They don't even have roofs over their heads. They don't have roofs over their heads. This is the place where Ithar was revealed. These were the streets where Umar ibn Khattab walked. You know, he walked in these streets to see if there was anybody hungry. And now you have, you know, the entire wealth of Saudi in the pockets of 5%. Of 5% in the same country. There's people, you know, who don't know where the next meal is going to come from. Half a mile from Masjid Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. No exaggeration. Just straight down that street, take a left, and you'll see a Mauritanian community. Well, we were shocked. The next day, alhamdulillah, the brothers went home, they got some money and they gave it to these people. But these are the streets where Umar walked. Umar radiallahu anhu would walk through the streets of Medina to see if there was anybody hungry. He would go through the streets of Medina to see anybody hungry. And upon occasion, he saw this woman in the distance. And this woman, she's got a fire lit. And on that fire, she's got a bowl. And in that bowl, there's only water. And what she's hoping, that her children who are crying around her, will think that she's cooking something. And they will fall asleep. And Umar was Amir al-Mu'mineen at the time. And Umar radiallahu anhu waited for a while. And then Umar saw what was happening and then he approached her and he gave her salam. And he asked her how she was. And then afterwards he asked her, he said, what's your opinion regarding Umar ibn Khattab? What's your opinion regarding Umar ibn Khattab? And she said, I complained to Allah about Umar ibn Khattab. I complained to Allah about Umar ibn Khattab. And he said, maybe he doesn't know your state. And she said, he's our Amir and he doesn't know the state of his subjects. And these words pierced the heart of Umar ibn Khattab. And the narration mentioned that Umar went back to Baytul Mal. And he told the keeper, he said, fill me a sack full of food. And he filled him a sack full of food. And then Umar said, place it on my back. And the keeper said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, let me carry it. And Umar said, place it on my back. And the keeper again said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, let me carry it. And upon the third time, Umar said, place it on my back. أَتَحْمِلُ أَنِّي ظُنُوبِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. He said, will you carry my sins also on the Day of Judgment? And then Umar, the narration mentioned, Umar walked through Medina. He was the most powerful man on the face of the earth at that time. With a sack on his back. And then he went to the tent. And the narration mentioned that he lit the fire himself and the fire was going through his beard. And then he cooked the food himself. And he fed the children himself. And his lady's watching all this. The lady's watching all this. And she didn't know that this is Umar ibn Khattab. And she says, but I swear to Allah, you are better than Umar ibn Khattab. I swear to Allah, you are better than Umar ibn Khattab. And then Abdul Rahman ibn Auf says that it was dark, it was cold. And I said, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, let's go back. It's cold, it's dark. And Umar radiallahu anhu said, I swear by Allah, I will not depart from this place until I see these children laughing like I saw them crying. And then Abdul Rahman ibn Auf says, I cannot express to you how Umar cried in the Fajr Salah. Because he had seen believers crying out of hunger. Because he had seen believers crying out of hunger. If any place Umar found that a person had died out of hunger, he would take blood money from every single person in that vicinity because it was their duty to look after that person. What do you think Umar would do if he was here today? We live in a global village. We see the suffering of others. What do you think he would do? You know, many of us, I'm telling you seriously, many of us, we become, you know, what we call as religious. You know, we grow our beards, we wear our hijabs, and we think we are religious. Because when they say somebody's practicing, that's what it is, isn't it? Oh, he's practicing, she's practicing. But never do they put their hand in their pocket to give. Because we think that our salah and our fasting and our beards and our hijab will take us into Jannah. We don't need to do anything else. We don't need to do anything else. And many who are not termed as practicing, they will spend. But we get deluded by our salahs and by our fasts and by our hijabs and niqabs and our beards, that we don't now no need to have good manners, to spend on people. The Prophet ﷺ said, Sayyidul Qawmi Khadimahum, the leader of any group of people is the one who does their khidmah, the one who serves. You got make a guy a emir of Islamic society, you know, now he's a emir. He isn't going to do anything anymore. He doesn't need to. He's going to boss everybody else around. You make somebody a president of a masjid, or make him a councillor or an MP, especially in our areas. You know, the real emirs were like the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ said the real leader is not necessarily the emir of the Islamic society, if he is the emir of the Islamic society. It's the one who does the running around, who does the khidmah. No, people may actually frown upon him, but in the eyes of Allah, he is the emir. Like Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr was Amir al-Mu'mineen. You know, look at all the virtues in the narrations regarding Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He could have said, you know, I'm guaranteed Jannah. I'm the Amir. I won't do anything. But Umar would see Abu Bakr would disappear every day after Fajr. And he thought, if Abu Bakr is going something, he must be doing something of khair. And he said, I pursued him. And I saw him enter this small home. And I came behind him to see. And he said, after a while, Abu Bakr came out. And I let him go, and then I entered the house. And he said, I saw an old blind lady. And I asked her, why did this man come to your house every day? And she said, he comes, he cooks, and he cleans my house, and he goes. And he said, do you know who this man is? And she said, no. And Umar began to cry. And he said, oh Bakr, you will tire those who come after you. You will tire those following your example who will come after you. See, he was a true leader, because he was their khadim. Sayyidul Qawmi Khadimhum. The leader of any group of people is that person who does their khidmah. And this is why, you know, that wealth that Allah has given us, alhamdulillah, nobody's saying, you know, go and live in a monastery or in a khanqah, or in a masjid. No. But understand that, do shukr upon what Allah has given you. And spend. And spend from it. Allah will put barakah. Allah will put barakah. And if you do not spend, and you see people suffering, then Allah will take away the barakah. Look at Abdullah ibn Mubarak. You know who Abdullah ibn Mubarak is? Abdullah ibn Mubarak was a mujahid. He was a muhaddith. You know, he, out of all the imams, this is his virtue, out of all the imams, the only man to not be disparaged by anybody was Abdullah ibn Mubarak. All the four imams were disparaged. All the hadith scholars, somebody criticized them. I mean, their criticism is not taken, but somebody criticized them. All the imams, latest, you know, Imam Abu Zayd, Sufyan al-Thawri, every single one of them was criticized, besides Abdullah ibn Mubarak. And anyway, he's an amazing personality. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak says, he would one year go for jihad, and the next year he would go for hajj. And he was in Khorasan, Central Asia. And he mentions that one day he performed hajj, finished the arkan, and he saw a dream, he saw two angels. And the angels are descending, and one is asking the other, how many people attended Hajj this year? And the angel said, 600,000 people. And he said, how many Hajj was accepted? And the angel said, not even one was accepted. Besides one man, who did not attend the Hajj, but his Hajj was accepted. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak says, I woke up and I was shaking that 600,000 people attended the Hajj and only one accepted. And they said, and then the angel said that he was a cobbler who lived in Damascus, and his name was Abdullah ibn Muqaffal. And he says, I went and set out straight away to meet this man. I went to Damascus and I asked for a man called Abdullah ibn Muqaffal, who was a cobbler. And they directed me to his house. And he says, I knocked on the door, and the man opened the door, and I said, are you Abdullah ibn Muqaffal? And he said, who wants to know? And he said, Abdullah ibn Mubarak radiallahu anhu told him the dream that he had. And Abdullah ibn Muqaffal said, I am Abdullah ibn Muqaffal. And he began to cry. And he said, tell me, why was your Hajj accepted? And so many people who attended Hajj, their Hajj was accepted. And he said, for 40 years, I'm a cobbler, I don't earn much. For 40 years, I wanted to go for Hajj. And I've been saving up for Hajj. And my wife became pregnant. And next door, they were cooking some meat. And my wife, you know, when women are pregnant, when they want something, they want it. And she smelled the meat, and she said, get me the meat. So he said, I went and I knocked on the door. And I said, you know, my wife desires some meat, can we have some meat? And the woman said, the meat is halal for us, but it's haram for you. And I said, how can it be halal for you and haram for us? He said, for days, we haven't had anything to eat. And I saw a donkey lying dead on the side of the street. And I cut a portion of it, and I brought it home to cook for my children. So it's halal for us and haram for you. And Abdullah says, I went home, all the money that I had gathered, I bought it, and I gave it to this lady. I gave it to this lady. And I said, this is my Hajj. He didn't attend Hajj, but his Hajj was accepted. And this had an amazing impact on Abdullah ibn Mubarak. The narration mentioned, see, Abdullah ibn Mubarak was a muhaddith. And he was, when you speak a person on a superlative, you know, very few, I read his book during, in Ramadan, one day my computer wasn't working, so I was sitting at Sufa, and I saw a book, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, it was in the library, I took it and I read it. All night I read it. I went to sleep after Fajr, I couldn't wake up to finish the book. He was such an amazing person. And this incident had an amazing impact on Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahmatullah alayhi, says that one day I was traveling for Hajj with my students. And we reached the village and we heard some crying from a certain house. And I told my student, go and check why they're crying. And they came back and they informed me that there's two girls, young girls in the house. And their parents don't have enough money to wed them off. And they're crying over this. And you know, in those days, Hajj wasn't that you jumped on Saudi Airlines direct to Medina. You know, nowadays, if it's not a direct flight, it's a huge issue. Can you imagine, you know, there was a time when people would go to a Hajj, only 50% would return. They would go from the depths of Africa, from the depths of Asia, from the, you know, the Caucasus. It would take months, but they will reach the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now if it's not a direct flight, and if we have to wait an hour or two, you know, it's chaos. It's chaos. And Abdullah Mubarak, they came and informed Abdullah Mubarak that they don't have enough money, their parents don't have enough money to wed them off. And the narration mentioned that Abdullah ibn Mubarak, who had traveled for weeks, left all his wealth with them. And he said, wed your children off. And he turned back home. He turned back home. And these were people who were imams. Because see, they cared about other people. They cared about other people. And it's due to the fact that today we have forgotten the concept of ithar. You know, al-mu'minuna ka jasadin wahid. The believers are like one body. If the head hurts, the entire body hurts. No, these people are hurting. These people are hurting. Who are hungry. Now, can you imagine how a mother feels? Put yourself in the same position. I guess none of you are parents, very few of you parents, but can you imagine that your child withers away in your hands because you don't have enough to feed it? Can you imagine that? And alhamdulillah, Allah has given us. You know, the Prophet was speaking about the donuts, and we have to sell donuts. But even that is a good thing. If you buy donuts with the niyyah, that alhamdulillah, the money will be spent for... even that is good, because this is a sunnah. This is a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to Medina, what did he do? He started a marketplace where Muslims bought from each other. And you know, the economy of Medina was in the hands of who? There's only a few of them. Who? Who could tell me? The Jews. The economy of Medina was in the hands of the Jews. And the Prophet ﷺ made Muslims, you know, deal with each other. When the Mushrikeen saw how upright the Muslims were in dealing, they decided to deal with the Muslims. And this is how the Prophet ﷺ broke the economic stronghold of the Jews over Medina. You know, because it was intelligent. So even if you buy with the niyyah, alhamdulillah, the money will be going to a good cause, you will get rewarded. You will get rewarded. But spend and trust in Allah. Spend and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And don't just spend on, you know, charity week. Have long term. You know, educate children. Sponsor a yateen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, who does the kafala of a yateen will be like this. Me and him will be like this in the Jannah. Like this. With the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sponsor yateens. You know, educate the yateens. And inshallah, I promise. Inshallah, why I promise? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam promised. If your niyyah is right, inshallah, Allah will put barakah in your wealth. Allah will put barakah in your wealth. I often say this, and I'll say it now, and I'll finish. Do your tarbiyah, or sit with people who will do your tarbiyah, that you become a person who, you know, is caring for other people. Who's caring for other Muslims. Who's caring for human beings. You know, become people who have a concern. Don't become people, you know, in universities, people have a lot of time, you know, and there's a lot of raw energy. You know, brothers start practicing, sisters start practicing. What is the practicing? What do? You know, as long as you're not practicing, we hate everybody who is practicing. Soon as we start practicing, we hate everybody who's not practicing, and we hate everybody who doesn't think like us, or doesn't pray like us. I mean, what kind of deen is this? The deen I learned was a deen which united, not divided. And we refine our argument so much that only we are in Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and you know, enough religion to hate. This is not the deen that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam bought. It was a deen which united. It was a deen which Aws and Khazraj, who were in some generation fighting for over 500 years. 500 years. And then they started practicing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became the leaders. And what did Allah say? Allah say, وَذْكُرُ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ عَدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَةِ إِخْوَانَ. Remember the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you were enemies. فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. And Allah brought your hearts together. فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَةِ إِخْوَانَ. And with His favor you became brothers. You became brothers. Now this is what the deen should be like. You should, when you view somebody, I say this, I know it gives indigestion to a lot of people, because it's easier to hate than like, you know. But when you view a person, another Muslim, what do you view him? Do you view him first that, or what mosque he prays at? Or is your overriding identity with that person, that he's a Muslim and you're a Muslim? Because I often hear this, you know, you go to colleges, you go to universities, the same thing. So be people, you know, who do your tarbiyah, that you're kind, you're soft. The time, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah loves gentleness in everything. When the Jews came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, you know, they said, Assalamu alaikum, may death be upon you. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Wa alaykum," and upon you as well. And Aisha radiallahu anha was sitting there, and she became enraged. She became enraged. And she said, you know, she began to curse him. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Calm down, O Aisha, calm down." And she said, "Did you hear what they said, O Messenger of Allah?" And the Prophet ﷺ said, "I replied to them, I said, upon you as well." And then he said, "O Aisha, Allah loves gentleness in everything. Allah loves gentleness in everything. Be gentle. You know, be kind to each other. Give each other smile, the sadaqah, and also start caring about others. You know, be people who spend, who do things for other people." I honestly, you know, this, we've opened a shop called Viva, I'm sure Basma, Viva Palestina on the Commentary Road. Yeah? The profits of that, everything we make, go to the Palestinian cause. The people who object the most on that shop are people who are practicing. I'll tell you why they object the most. Because for them, it's not important. The Palestinian cause or the suffering of the Palestinians is not important. For them, you know, where you put your hand in Salah is important. You know, what mosque you go in is important. What ikhtilaf, that is an important. And I see this all the time. Every time, luckily I got a brother who knows nothing in the shop. So when they come in, they say, "Oh, you got these beads, these bidah beads. Is it your sheikh's? Is that all you can speak about? You know, is that all you can speak about? 1400 years and you haven't sorted your salah out yet?" I got no problem. Listen, I got no problem. Look, people sometimes criticize me. They say, "Look, you knock certain groups." I only knock people who cause ikhtilaf. So if there's somebody causing a fitna, yes, I will speak out against them. But brothers, you know, can pray different to me, can go to a different masjid to me, alhamdulillah, they're my Muslim brothers. As long as they have the ability to speak like human beings with each other, like brothers with each other, that's accepted. And the problem is, you know, seriously, we start practicing and the first thing we do, what? Put fatwas of kufr on other people. You know, when we went on the convoy to Gaza, this was an amazing thing. There were some brothers who on the convoy, just two, not some, who would not pray behind anybody else on the convoy. Why? Because they said the guys praying, leading the salah are Wahhabis. Okay? The Wahhabis. You know the curse word Wahhabis. Yeah? They, you know, in certain parts of the world, you call somebody a Wahhabi, it's game over. It's true. It's game over. You know, I used to have a friend when I was, before I started practicing, when I used to go to a secondary school. This guy, he knew nothing about religion, and I knew nothing about religion at the time. But his worst swear was this. You know, after the F's, after the B's, the worst swear that he had, when you really annoyed him, is Wabi Kafir. Wabi Kafir. You know, there's a story, although it's made up, that in India there was a Hindu shop owner. And this Hindu shop owner, you know, the local imam would come and take credit from him. And the imam sahab wouldn't pay. So the Hindu shop owner said, "Imam sahab, please pay." He said, next week came. He said, "Okay, your credit's finished." The imam sahab said, "Don't stop my credit, you'll regret it." He said, "No, it's finished." So imam sahab ascended the pulpit on Friday and he said, "I have announcement to make. You know that Hindu shop owner, he's become a Wahhabi. Boycott his shop." So everybody boycotted his shop. And this is no exaggeration. I was at the Somalian, you know, Laziz Lounge, the mosque across the road, the Somalian mosque. Yeah? And I asked some youngsters, I said, "Do you know where the Somalian masjid is?" You know, Somalian. They said, "Yeah, uncle, is that 8-9? Uncle, it's that one there, uncle." Yeah, so, but then there goes to me, little 8-9 year old kids, "Uncle, it's a Wadi Masjid." So, the shop owner came back to the Imam Sahib and he said, "Oh, please Imam Sahib, forgive me, you know, you can have as much credit as you want." So Imam Sahib said, "Okay." So next week Imam Sahib ascended the pulpit and he said, "Alhamdulillah, I have good news. You know, the Wahhabi, the Hindu shop owner who had become a Wahhabi, alhamdulillah, he's reverted to becoming a Sunni again." But this is the thing, you know, you give other people these titles, and you give yourself rosy titles which make us feel good about ourselves. And the story, these two brothers wouldn't pray behind Wahhabis. They wouldn't pray behind Wahhabis. But then I explained to them, I said, listen, you know what? You're going to Gaza, aren't you? I said, you know the vast majority of the ruling elite, Hamas, are a splinter group of Ikhwan. And Ikhwan are Wahhabis. I said, so you're traveling the other side of the world to help Wahhabis, but you're not ready to pray Salah behind the Wahhabis. And this is an amazing thing. So, you know, review how you judge each other.